Okay. Please copy the title. You will say that why I've written three standards together. Because even though, see, that's the advantage of studying in writing form. Even though I'll be discussing on audit evidence, which is SA500, but this standard is so wide that it automatically covers provisions of 505 and 520. That means the main standard is 500, which covers these two automatically. And since we are making the notes at the exam time, I don't have to study them separately. I'll be studying together with 500. Got my point? Okay. Yeah, let's start now. Pay attention. Out of these three standards which I have written, the external confirmation is the most important one. So I am telling you, and whatever questions I mark important, they generally come in exam, so please don't forget to write important. So external confirmation, out of these three, are important. Now, if an auditor is conducting his audit, what is the rule? The rule is very simple. I have made this statement several times that an auditor should obtain sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. You know, in almost all the standards of auditing, you will find that the statement is given. So even if I repeat it 10 times, it's because the statement is available 10 times in different standards. Okay. So as an auditor, my job is to obtain sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. Now, even if I don't tell you what is audit evidence, in that case, the rule is very simple that I have to obtain some proof of doing auditing. Or while doing auditing, there has to be some conclusions drawn so that I can frame my audit evidence. Silence, that side. Please maintain silence. Listen to what I'm saying. This is going to help you in writing your answers, because in exam, you will not be able to even frame the answers properly. So listen to what I'm saying. So as an auditor, SA500, though I'll be teaching you, which will be audit evidence, but then I'll be also covering 505, which is external confirmations, and 520, which is analytical review procedures. Okay, very simple and very systematic, logical standard. This is not difficult at all. Why I'm obtaining audit evidence? Because I told you that based on sufficient evidence, I can draw my conclusion. In fact, I would say like this, that in this standard, I'll be teaching you that there are certain methods of obtaining audit evidence. And see, I've already written there. There are five different methods of obtaining audit evidence, and you just have to remember one sentence on each method so that you can write the answer if it comes. They're very easy, absolutely easy methods they are. Only thing is, you have to remember so many methods to obtain sufficient audit evidence. I can still listen some noise. Please stop. Listen to what I'm saying. When I stop, you don't talk. When I don't talk, then you talk. Okay, I'll give you the permission to talk, but don't. When I'm explaining something, please listen. I can understand that you're feeling tired. I'll try to help you. I'll try to leave you a little early if you want. Okay? Abhi, you can clap if you want. I'll leave you early. See, I don't want to catch you like this, you know, and no, you sit here for up to 2 o'clock, you sit. I can understand your problem, you know. So I'll leave you early, but first you tell me. I should also receive that same cooperation that I should, you know, when I'm talking, you don't talk. So if I talk something, it's for your, it's going to credit your marks, not mine. So just pay attention. 500, there are how many methods? What is the name of SA500? Auditor should obtain what type of audit evidence? Sufficient and? Sufficient. Then I'll describe also what is sufficient and what is appropriate. But first you tell me, auditor should obtain what type of audit evidence? sufficient and appropriate. Okay, so SA 500 is basically giving you, suggesting you some methods of obtaining audit evidence. Now listen what these methods are. The very first and the most simplest method of obtaining audit evidence is inspection. What is the method? I will not tell you also, you will understand yourself what you mean by inspection. See, this is a document kept in front of me. When I'm checking what is written in the document, I'm inspecting the data. So inspection simply means to check. Okay, now I can check two things here. One, documents, and I can even verify tangible assets. What do you mean by tangible assets? Can I verify? Can I inspect goodwill? Goodwill is tangible. So what I'm saying, inspection simply means what? That you are inspecting, that means you're checking documents and tangible assets. So when an auditor goes in a company and he starts checking the documents and tangible assets, that type of activity, what he's doing is called as what? Inspection. Inspection literally means to check something. Inspection literally means to check something. Okay. But now suppose I don't say that this is the only method which is available with the auditor. He can, after doing inspection, if he's still not convinced, he can observe also. So the next method to obtain audit evidence is what? Observation. Now, you know, see how to observe. You don't have to do anything. Just stand. You know, but when I'm observing something, as a professional, something is going in my mind that I have to comment also on what I'm observing. Are you getting this point? That means as an auditor, suppose, you know what happened? You would have heard about that game, bowling.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I got a chance to do audit of bowling company. Bowling company is a listed company. It's a listed company on stock exchange. Yeah, I don't clap. I'll tell you the whole reason how it works. Those companies, you know, when you go at their centers where they are operating this game bowling and where people come and they play the game, they will give some token coin to the person. You know, you put this token coin and then you can, you know, play the game. What people do normally, you know, there are the staff. Suppose if one of my friend is, you know, the employee there and he's using, you know, he's a person who is responsible for giving tokens. When you give a token to a person, you have to collect money also from that person. This person, what he did, he changed the ringtone. I'll give you a better ringtone. Okay, so basically, so what happened, you know, this person who was my friend, he issued me the token coin to play the game without charging money, just because he was my friend. But if a person, if an employee is my friend, that does not mean that the whole company is my friend. Okay, that means company needs revenue. If the game starts, electricity cost is incurred. Okay, there are other overheads also. I have to pay salary to the employee. You tell me one thing, just because one person is a friend, so he is offering you a token coin free to play the game. I did not pay because I told you, you are my friend, no, please, you have one coin. So I just played and I just went away. Like this he did for some people. Tell me, are these strong internal controls or weak internal controls? It's a weak internal control. How can an employee just issue, and one token coin is supposed for 100 rupees, and if you are issuing two tokens, that means there is a loss of 200 rupees, plus company has to constantly bear that overhead cost because game will operate, electricity charges will be incurred. You tell me one thing, what did I do as an auditor? Suppose if I am the auditor of bowling company, what were we supposed to do, you know? We were just supposed to go and observe whether the token coins were issued and money was collected or not. And the person who is issuing the token coin was not even knowing that, you know, this person is acting as an auditor. That means auditors will never go and, you know, they wear a police uniform and they carry a gun with them. Okay, if you do nothing, you know, anything, if you've done, I will just remove the gun and shoot you. As a auditor is not a bloodhound, he's a watchdog. Have you heard this word before? What's the difference between a watchdog and a bloodhound? Both are dogs, both are dogs only, but the watchdog is just going to keep a watch on what you're doing. He's like a sniffer dog, you know, and the bloodhound will literally go and bite the person, you know, he will tumhara pura khun nikal lega. So it's like that. So when I'm saying a watchdog and a bloodhound, what I'm trying to tell you, auditor is just a watchdog. you cannot put someone behind bars, you cannot punish that person, no? You can only comment on that person, then let the company decide what the company has to do. Is it clear or not? So what I'm telling you is that whenever I was given an opportunity to do that bowling company audit, we were just observing that. We were not doing anything, we were not checking. Had I started checking something, then it was inspection. We were observing. So when I use the word observation, even observation is a method to obtain audit evidence. But in observation, what I do, I try to witness something. You know, FIR reports, if there is an accident on the road, you have to witness that and then you have to make a first information report. So what I'm doing here, I'm trying to witness a process, okay? So when I'm witnessing a process, basically what does it imply is that I've done observation. Observation, let me tell you, audit evidence can be oral also. This is oral evidence, okay? Or it can be even visual also. So that means orally somebody told you that he's issuing free token coins, or visually you go and observe something. So visual, when you visualize something or when orally somebody tells you, you are actually not inspecting anything. Because see, in inspection, there is always something called as documentation, okay? Or there's something called as tangibility, which is missing as far as the observations are concerned. So when I say what was the first method, it was simply inspection, then you have observation. But then these are not the only methods of doing audit or obtaining audit evidence. There are other methods also. Like the third one which I want to write, which is one of the important ones, is inquiry. Now how do you spell? Some people write EN. It's not EN, it's a professional inquiry, that is why it's IN, okay? Inquiry. Now what do you mean by inquiry? Inquiry simply means that you have to obtain some information and explanation. The term inquiry means obtain some information and explanation. And let me tell you, there are two ways of doing inquiry. Either you can do an internal inquiry or you can do an external inquiry. Now, first of all, internal inquiry is very easy. If I go and if I communicate with the accountant, suppose if he is the accountant and if I'm going and communicating something to him, okay? So, So if this person is an accountant and if I talk to him, basically what I've done, I've obtained information. So when I've obtained information and explanation from an accountant, it is called as an internal inquiry. Understand what I'm saying. Instead of talking, please understand. Abhi, you don't know anything. When you learn something, you'll be able to write something. So this person, accountant, when he speaks to an auditor, when he gives an information to an auditor, suppose I ask him a very simple question. You please tell me, you know what is bank reconciliation?
Yes, sir.
Tell me, is it advisable for a company to do bank reconciliation once in a month, or is it advisable to do once in a year? What do you suggest? Once in a month, once in a year? Company gives you a contention that I don't have staff, that is why I do once in a year. Array, if you don't have staff, appoint the staff, because otherwise your internal controls will be weak. Suppose if you do once in a year bank reconciliation, there could be so many entries which will be skipped out also. You will not even come to know at the end of the year how many entries have been skipped out. So tell me, are there internal controls when company is doing reconciliation once in a year? Array, they are there, but they are not strong internal controls. I told you a door is there, but having a lock on door is a better internal controls. Have you understood this point? That means if a company is doing a monthly reconciliation, now is the internal control there? It is there also and it is adequate also. Have you understood? So basically internal controls, who told me all this? The accountant. What did I do? I communicated this and I obtained information from the accountant. Such type of information is called as what? Internal inquiry. But there is one more inquiry called as external inquiry. Now if I tell you external inquiry means you are actually obtaining external confirmation. You have written that name also. SA 505, which speaks on external confirmation. You know, sometimes what the accountant tells me, I am not able to justify myself, or I am not able to place complete reliability on what the accountant told me. If an accountant talks to me, he is giving me the information, but I believe that I should do more counter checking of the information. That means I should go and I should check the information in even more detail. Cross checking, you can just call it as what? Cross checking. So if the accountant tells me a particular balance of a person, say he tells me debtor's balances. As an auditor, you know what I did? I actually called upon the debtor and asked him that, sir, if my balance sheet shows that so much is receivable from you, is your balance sheet showing so much payable to me? You understood what I said?
Yes,
that means if my balance sheet is showing that X amount is receivable, that means the debtor's balance sheet should show that X amount is payable to the company. That means this is a counter checking. But see, I use the word I call the debtor. When I say I call the debtor, there is a formal method of calling. You can't send him a WhatsApp or, you know, an email and saying that, you know, you just tell me on a WhatsApp what is the balance available in your balance sheet. There has to be a format for calling the debtor. So when I'm saying I'm obtaining external confirmation, see, external confirmation, here you have a particular standard on external confirmation, 505. The name of the standard itself is external. And you know what is external confirmation? It is one of the method of obtaining audit evidence, and in the form of what? Inquiry. What's happening here? In external confirmation, if I want to confirm debtor's balances, who is the right third party to go and inquire? The debtor himself. The debtor himself. Basically, external confirmation means you're obtaining confirmation balances from which party, you know? Third party. But in an internal inquiry, I speak to the internal party, who is the accountant of the company. Acha, tell me, if you are a creditor, who is the right person to answer? Acha, if you are having some loans taken from bank, so loan balances, can I say the bank manager can be a right person to answer this question? Yeah, so basically what I'm trying to give you examples. Acha, tell me, if there is a suit which is pending, tell me, who is the right person to answer this question? A lawyer can tell me where exactly, what is the position of the suit which is pending. So basically all these parties which I'm writing here are the third parties. So what is external confirmation? External confirmation means an auditor should go and he should formally communicate. Formally, he should not go and send him a WhatsApp. I told you, no informal communication, formal communication is required. So when I'm saying formally communicate, formally how he'll communicate? Acha, he has to prepare a request form here. You know, if you go and give an interview today in a company, suppose suddenly you imagine that you cleared CA exam, okay? Just imagine, how are you feeling now? Okay, he's feeling awesome, he's cleared CA exam. So now the company calls him for an interview, and in the interview, he's told to prepare a checklist. You know what's a checklist? It will be having a list of questions. So, you know, sometimes in the college, the evaluation takes place, for a teacher evaluation takes place. So you are given a questionnaire, you have to prepare the question. You always write wrong things about teachers, you know, which actually is not true. But just because teacher did not give you marks, so you say that teacher is not good, but that is not true. So this type of questionnaire is given to an employee also, prospective employee. So this person, he went for an interview and he was told to fill a list of questions. So as an auditor, when I have to obtain inquiry, you know, in the form of external confirmation, I have to give a questionnaire. What's a questionnaire? It will contain list of some questions which the person is supposed to answer. And after he gives me the answers, I will be expressing my opinion. Tell me one thing. Now I'm seeing whether you've really understood or not. Tell me one thing. If these third parties don't answer to the questionnaire, can I give a disclaimer of opinion? You pounce on the question. First you think what I'm asking. I'm asking, if these third parties don't give you a response to the questionnaire, can you give a disclaimer of opinion? Of course, yes, you did not get sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. So if you did not get sufficient and appropriate audit evidence, can I say you can always give a disclaimer of opinion? Have you understood or not? That means if an auditor is unable to obtain external confirmation on account of any reason, he will always execute a disclaimer of opinion. Have you understood? So what is external confirmation? It means obtaining evidence from which party? Which party? Acha, third party can be a debtor, can be a creditor, can be a bank manager, lawyer. Anybody can be a third party. So basically speaking, auditor has to formally request the third party by preparing a questionnaire, and on that questionnaire the third party will give its responses. Have you understood this point? Acha, now suppose if I ask you a question here, that there is something called as analytical review procedures. Have you written this name? Yeah, see, you would have written it as 520, analytical review procedures. Now, analytical review procedure is also a standard. Analytical review procedure is also a standard. If I can, you know, when you will get the textbook, you will be finding this as a standard. See, look here. It's a very small standard, very easy to understand. Analytical review. But though it looks small, see, looks are always deceptive. Don't go by the looks. Looks may be, you know, small, but the concept is very, very technical in nature. I will just give you a concept. You just try to answer this question. This is analytical procedure, SA 520. You know how this concept works? It works like this. Suppose if I make a, you know, a data here and I just want you to analyze the data. You are the auditor. You know what's a GP ratio? Acha, what's an NP ratio, you know? Acha, what is earning per share, you know? What is earning per share? What does earning per share indicates? Anyone will answer, raise hand. What does earning per share indicates? See, there are so many people, but then still answer is not coming. Say, profit available per shareholder. Okay, fine. But how do you interpret earnings per share? For a layman, how do you interpret earnings per share? The return, then what is return on investment then? Like that, huh? Dividend declared per share. This is a disaster. This is formula. That's mechanical approach. I want logical. How much profit is? Okay, I agree to some extent to what he says. How much profit is earned by? A unit of investment. Okay, maybe, you know, this answer is not full-fledged, but I will not say it's wrong also. Somewhat it is correct. Acha, yeah, anyone? That can be market price also. Say, anyone would like to answer this question? What is earning per share? Yeah, please stand and answer. Say. I don't take the names, let the person answer. Say, so fourth last bench, who raised hand? He's counting whether I'm fourth last or fifth last. Nobody will answer this question? Yeah, say. He's answering, listen. Profits earned by? Profits available to? Okay, again, you are 70-80% correct. I don't say you're wrong, but this person and this person has actually given the correct answer. Rest all don't know. I don't know from where you are getting the answers. You know, simple. You know, just to tell you this word, I have to actually read two books to tell you the simple word that what is earnings per share meaning. Okay, that means you can just imagine the research done to make you understand or to make a shareholder understand a concept. This is what an auditor has to do. A lot of research is done. Look here, earnings per share, you know, it indicates the performance of the company. Now anybody will say that it's very simple, performance of the company. Aray, if it was simple, why didn't you say then? Okay, so earning per share indicates what? The performance of the company. Then you can say, how does the performance can be reflected based on the earnings which are available for the equity shareholders? Is it necessary for a company to give equity dividends or equity returns to every year to equity shareholders? No obligation like that. If the company wants, it can give some dividends. Otherwise, it's not necessary for a company to give dividends to its equity shareholders. Now, what I'm trying to tell you is that whenever we are talking about the performance of the company, it means I'm writing here, you tell me whether performance is good or not. This is the previous year and this is the current year of the company. Let's take an example. And whatever you'll be doing here, you only decide whether it's analytical review or not. What is analytical review? Let's understand. Suppose if in the previous year the gross profit was 9% and in the current year it is 10%. Okay, now net profit was 4%, in the current year it became 3.5%. Look here closely and tell me, is it possible that in spite of increase in the gross profit, the net profits have gone down?
Yes, sir.
Because company is not able to control its indirect expenditure. Okay, so net profits. Achha, tell me, if the net profits go down, do they have a direct bearing on the earning per share? Suppose last year earning per share was rupees 2 per share and this is rupees 1.8 per share. And this is earning per share on a face value of rupees 10. What is face value? It's the value which is written in the balance sheet. Achha, is the face value and market value same? It's not the same. That means I am talking about face value here, the book value of the company. Achha, you tell me one thing. Suppose if this is the data available in front of you and you are told to analyze the data, what analysis you will do here? Anybody can analyze this data? If they ask you this question in exam, you will say, you know, you did not tell in classroom. Array, but these type of questions are not to be told. You have to apply your mind here because this requires more than auditing accounting knowledge. Suppose if this 4 marks question has already come in exam, analyze the data. What will you analyze? Tell me one thing. If I say company is able to improve its sales volumes because of which the gross profit has gone up. That could be one reason. I'm not saying that's the only reason. That could be one reason. If company is able to improve its sales, can I say that could be one reason for improve its sales? I'm not saying increasing a selling price. I asked this question to one student. He told, sir, when the company is increasing selling price, the gross profit will go high. Tell me, if you increase your selling price, will the customer come and buy product from you? If you are increasing your selling price, customer would be least bothered about you. He will say, I'll go and buy a cheaper option, which is the same quality product available in market. Are you understanding? That means increasing sales volume could be one of the reason to increase the gross profit. Acha, one more. Suppose if I'm increasing the sales volume, in spite of that, I'm not able to, you know, control towards my electricity cost. My electricity cost is a rising cost. It keeps on increasing every time. So because of which some, or maybe I would have charged a higher depreciation this year on my fixed assets. So because of which my net profit has gone down. Tell me one thing, if my net profit goes down, my earning per share also goes down. So you tell me, so overall, look at this scenario and tell me, is the overall performance improved or it has diminished? Is it improved or is it diminished? Diminished. Is it diminished? Because see here, the last year earning was 2, this year earning has become 1.8 per share. That means, can I say that the performance of the company, which is reflected by earnings per share, has diminished remarkably? Tumhare liye, for you it is suppose 20 paise reduction. But for company, you know, it runs into crores and crores of rupees even if 20 paise reduction takes place in earnings per share. Are you understanding this point? Acha, when I compared these two earning per share, you know, what did I actually do? I am assuming that the number of equity shares are same at both the places. You understood what I said? Arey, please analyze. CA students don't know how to analyze only. Forget this. First, you try to analyze what I'm saying. If I'm writing here earning per share 2 or 1.8, it means my number of equity shares have remained the same. Then, suppose if my number of equity shares in yahan pe number of equity shares become 1500 and yahan pe they were still 1000. Is this earning per share comparable?
No.
Earning per share is only comparable when the denominator is same. Now, somebody told me the formula here, net profit minus preference dividend divided by number of equity shares. So, can I say in both the years, the equity shares have to be same only, then only I can compare the earning per share. Are you understanding? Whatever I'm teaching you just now, the auditor has to practically do all these things. And you know, this type of exercise is called as what? Analytical review procedures. What is analytical review procedures? It means management will give you some ratios. Management will give you some trends, ratios and trends. See, this is a trend. Past year, current year is a trend. Then inside the trend, there are some ratios. You have to see the ratio and then you have to explain the impact of those ratios. Tell me, the first method of obtaining audit evidence was inspection. How different is this method from that one? Remarkably different. See the difference. Yahan pe you are analyzing the data, there you are actually inspecting the document. Mechanical approach it was. But here it is totally intelligent approach. You know, this type of data helps you in preparing projected financial statements also. Have you heard this word? Projected. What is projected? Future year. Anyone who wants to become the CFO of the company? Are you know who is a CFO?
Yes,
yeah, who is a CFO? What is the role of a CFO? You want to become but you don't know. He has to basically see the financial plans and policies of the company. Okay. Understand. Look here. Say this is current year. This was previous year. Any good CFO would like to answer this question. What was my gross profit in the previous year? What was it in the current year? What is the projection now? 11%? There is one optimistic CFO who is saying 20%. How much? 20%. Okay. Any other CFO? Achha, you should you know, tell on some grounds. CFO just cannot, this is like, we are not gambling here. Okay. This is not gambling. There has to be certain grounds when you say, achha, on what grounds you said 20%? He's saying maybe the sales would have gone up because of which the gross profit would have doubled the sales. Okay. Acha. Now can I say he's actually what he's doing, you know, guesswork. This person is doing guesswork. Somebody else wants to do something else apart from guesswork. You have learned mathematics or not? Use mathematics. Somebody is saying 9.5. You know what he has done? He has used the mean approach. Average. Statistics he is using. Yeah, someone? 11%? Acha. Somebody is saying 11%. Maybe he is using the trend analysis approach. The economics approach. Acha, you tell me one thing. You tell me one thing. Different CFOs are giving me different answers. But suppose if the answer comes, the actual profit comes as 10.5. Who is more closer? Who is more closer? See, don't you think there can be a difference between the estimated and the actual? Projected means estimated or actual? Now actually it came as 10.5. So what's the difference? That means who is more closer? The 11%, his answer is more accurate. Acha, you tell me, if the answer is more accurate, he will be called as the best CFO for the company. You know, if you want to rank a CFO, you have to see his precision. Please clap first. If you want to listen, if you want to rank a CFO, this is the precision of his decision. If you are deciding which is much more real and much more closer, then you can rank the CFO. Are you understanding this point? Acha, tell me, say this person. This person said trend, he used guesswork and he said 20%. The profit came 19%. Who is the best CFO now? This person will become best CFO and the company will throw out this person. You yourself can decide your faith in the company. How much long you will be surviving in the company is based on how much decisions you are taking. Okay, so what I've done here, you know, listen, what I've done here, I've done analytical review procedures. These CFOs who are giving decisions, they are actually doing analytical review procedures in the company. And based on their analytical review, they can either do guesswork or they can do, you know, some mathematical approach to give. But actually speaking, when I, as an auditor, I have analyzed these people, I have obtained audit evidence. When as an auditor, I have analyzed this type of situation, I have obtained audit evidence. So obtaining audit evidence by analytical, I am not making you mug up anything. It's purely logical. What is analytical review? It is a technique of obtaining audit evidence where you use ratio analysis and trend analysis. And after using ratios and trend analysis, you are in a state to decide whether the financial position is healthy or not. That is called as analytical review procedure. Have you understood? There is one more method also which is remaining. But before I can give you that method, can we please write it down? So there are 5 methods I told you. I have explained you 4. Have you updated your index?
Yes,
sir. Yeah, please update your index also. Okay, first point. Write down. What is the first statement that you'll always make? Auditor should obtain sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. Write down. Auditor should obtain sufficient and appropriate. Should obtain sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. Sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. In order to express his opinion, and there are 5 methods of obtaining sufficient. There are 5 methods of obtaining sufficient and appropriate audit evidences. 5 methods of obtaining sufficient and appropriate audit evidences. five methods of obtaining sufficient and appropriate audit. Which is the first one?
Inspection.
Excellent. Write down inspection. Wow. Inspection. So underline inspection और उसके आगे लिखो inspection involves I'm saying inspection involves checking of documents and tangible assets in order to obtain sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. Checking of documents and tangible assets in order to obtain sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. Full stop. This method cannot be applied to verify intangibles like goodwill. Full stop. Next point. What is the next method?
Observation.
Write down observation. Underline that observation and write down. It involves witnessing a process. Observation involves witnessing. Here's the spelling. To witness a process involves witnessing a process followed by the management in order to ensure that its internal controls are adequate. Internal controls are adequate. Full stop. For example, it is the responsibility of the management to conduct stock verification on a regular basis. And it is the responsibility of an auditor to witness the process of stock verification to find out inadequacies of internal controls. Okay, before I proceed, कोई भी spelling नहीं आएगा, please पूछ लेने का. हम लोग हिंदी में बोलते हैं शर्माने का मत. Okay, पूछ लेने का. Spelling, if you don't know, please ask me. Okay, please ask me. Feel free to ask. From the last bench also, somebody is asking. I'll write it on the board. But I expect that you should know, because I'm the words which I'm using are very, very simple. You know, any difficult word, I'll write the spelling. Next point, dikho. Write the next point. What's the next point? What's the next method? Inquiry. Write down. Write down inquiry. Inquiry means obtaining. Inquiry means obtaining information and explanation. Inquiry means obtaining information and explanation either from a person who is internal or external to an organization. Who is internal or external to an organization. Full stop. An internal inquiry involves communicating with the staff within the management that is someone like an accountant whereas an external inquiry is also called as come on, tell me, what is it also called as? Are external inquiry is also called as what? External confirmation. Please underline this word. Now, whatever dictation I'll be giving you for this word, it will be only for this word, external confirmation. And what will you underline and write in the bracket? SA505. So if they ask you a question on SA505, this whole note, what I'm dictating just now, you need to write. Okay? Exam mein question dikhe sab chhaap dene ka. Jaisa, haan. You just have to wait till the question is being asked. Once the question is asked, just, you know, you have to write the answer for it, but for that you'll have to think that much. So from now only I'm making you write and think. So if you're thinking, it becomes easier for you to write in the exam. What did you write in bracket? 505. Next line. External confirmation involves obtaining audit evidence from which party?
Third party.
From third party over and above the internal inquiry. Full stop. Following are some of the situations where an auditor can obtain an external confirmation. Auditor can obtain an external confirmation. You remember I had written some situations, which were they? Because you have to give examples. So what will you write? For debtors' balances, write down. For debtors' balances, Who is the third party? Yeah, please write out. For debtors' balances, arrow, debtors. For creditors' balances, arrow, creditors. For loan balances, bank managers. For loan balances, bank managers. For suits which are pending, lawyers. Suits which are pending, lawyers. Next point. You wrote all these examples? Okay, right. I'll give you some more also. Like, suppose if I make an investment, yeah, anyone can answer this question. If there are investments made, who is the external party? Investments made. Are you know there is something called as a stock broker? Have you ever heard this name, broker? So likho. Investments brokers. You know, listen, this one CA final question. One creditor told me that I have supplied goods, but I tell him I have not received the goods. Okay, so who was the party who can tell me where exactly the goods are? Transporter. Excellent answer. Superb, intelligent people you are. Superb people. So suppose if it is stock in transit, right? Stock in transit. Who is the third party? Transporter. So stock in transit will be transporter. Okay, this is sufficient now. So many examples we have written. Next point. An auditor should An auditor should. Are have you written so much? Yeah. An auditor should obtain external confirmation. Next point. Auditor should obtain external confirmation. Should obtain external confirmation. By making a formal request. Making a formal request to the third party. Formal request to the third party. Full stop. He should design a questionnaire. Seek responses from the third party. After obtaining responses, an auditor should express his opinion in his audit report. Stop. If due to any reason an auditor is unable to obtain an external confirmation, then then so tell me which opinion he will give. Very good. He will give a disclaimer of opinion. Then he will give a disclaimer of opinion. He will give a disclaimer of opinion. Please underline this word, disclaimer. Examiners are looking for such words: formal, disclaimer, request. Okay, I need to tell you 5 methods out of which I have told you 4. One is still remaining, but you tell me, have you understood all 4?
Yes, sir.
Properly, have you understood?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and no enthusiasm only. Have you understood?
Yes, sir.
Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, before I can tell you the fifth one, I want people to take 1 minute, you know, breathing break and read what you have written. Read what you have written. And breathing break. Please understand. Okay. Now, there was only one method There was only one method which was remaining. And you can look on the board, what is the name of that method? Yeah, once you know it came as a short note, and that also in the very recent auditing paper, what are known as cutoff procedures. The concept is very simple. Understand here. What are known as cutoff procedures? Suppose if I purchase stock and it is entered in the purchase register on 30th of March, that's the day of purchase. You listen to this example, otherwise you will not be able to write the answer. So suppose if I purchase the stock and the date of purchase is 30th of March 2014, say for example. But you know what mistake has happened? In the purchase register, the warehouse keeper has recorded this stock on 30th of March 2014, but it is entered in the accounts on 2nd of April 2014. I will repeat once again for those who have come just now, so please pay attention, don't talk. It is entered in the purchase register on 30th of March, but the person who is doing accounts has recorded the same stock on 2nd of April 2014. Can you tell me what is the mistake here? Achha, tell me, yeah, what has happened here, you know? It's a matter of only 2-3 days that the, you know, entry was delayed as far as the accounts are concerned. But you tell me, year has changed here?
Yes, sir.
The financial year has changed here?
Yes, sir.
So if the financial year has changed now, you tell me, how will my profit and loss account and balance sheet, which is made out of these accounts, will give me a true and fair view? Is it going to give me a true and fair view? Because if I go backwards, I told you, if you're checking balance sheet in modern audit, you have to go backward and see the purchase register and sale register also. So the sale register or purchase register entries do not coincide with the entries on what is written in the profit and loss account and balance sheet. So tell me, true and fair view will be there or not?
Not.
So that means, what is cutoff procedure? Cutoff procedure is a method which is for, it's a technique which is followed by an auditor just to ensure that whenever any transaction is being recorded in the books of accounts, it should tally with the transaction which is given in the purchase register also. That means the date of passing the purchase register entry should be equal to the date of passing entry in the books of accounts. Are you understanding this point? That means if this point is not, so what is cutoff? Cutoff date means 31st March. That means my transaction of 30th March should have been entered in the financial statements by 31st March itself. And if it is not entering by 31st March itself, that means the controls are weak here and the concept is not showing me a true and fair view. So that is also one of the methods through which you can obtain sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. Is it clear? Yeah. So can we just make a note of what is cutoff procedure also? So we'll finish off this standard completely. Analytical review I have not given. Okay. So we'll first write analytical review also. So method number 4, analytical review procedures. Method 4, analytical review procedures. Write down. Analytical review procedures. You can use the short form ARP. ARP means analytical review procedures. Write down first point. It is a financial management technique which is applied by an auditor to obtain sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. Sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. evaluates significant ratios and trends and trends and identifies and identifies evaluates significant ratios and trends and identifies fluctuations in them identifies fluctuations in them full stop next point it is always advisable next point it is always advisable for an auditor it is always advisable for an auditor to perform analytical review it is always advisable for an auditor to perform analytical review at the end of the year at the end of the year for obtaining better results for obtaining better results Good stop by performing analytical review by performing analytical review an auditor can even make projections an auditor can even make projections for the future years can even make projections for the future years and can help the management and can help the management help the management to prepare budgets do you know what's a budget yeah it's a financial plan help the management to prepare budgets full stop next is cutoff procedures what is the next method cutoff procedures write down cutoff procedures involves what's the heading cutoff procedures so you write there cutoff procedures involves enabling the fact cutoff procedures involves enabling the fact that the previous year balances the previous year balances are not recorded in the current year are not recorded in the current year in the current year as it would affect in the current year as it would affect the true and fair view as it would affect the true and fair view full stop at the year end hence at the year end an auditor should apply this technique auditor should apply this technique to check the efficiency check the efficiency of accountant's work Full stop if cutoff procedures are not performed if cutoff procedures are not performed then it is probable if cutoff procedures are not performed then it is probable that financial statements, it is probable that financial statements will not reflect, financial statements will not reflect, will not reflect a true and fair view. Financial statements will not reflect a true and fair view. Full stop.